Welcome back to our time of worship. We consider God's Word this morning, and we have three lessons for today. The first one is from Genesis, talking about Abraham. The second one from Paul's Epistle to the Romans, and the third coming from the Gospel of Matthew. Genesis 18, we'll be reading the verses 1 through 15. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre, where he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and you may all wash your feet and rest under this tree. Let me get you something to eat so that you can be refreshed and then go on your way now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered. "Do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get three seahs of the finest flour and knead it and bake some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice, tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While they ate, he stood near them under a tree. "Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There in the tent," he said. Then one of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now, Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him. Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was well past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have a child now that I am old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied and said, "I did not laugh." But he said, "Yes, you did laugh." The word of the Lord. From the Epistle Romans, chapter 5, the verses 1 through 8. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, while we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die, but God demonstrated his own life for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord. From the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 8 and chapter 9, we'll be reading the verses 35 and then going through chapter 10, verse 8. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Jesus called his 12 disciples to and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who's also called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: do not go among the Gentiles or enter any of the towns of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. The word of the Lord. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, use this word, inspired by you, be breathed into our life, that we may learn to trust, and in trusting to hope, and in hoping to love, that all that we are may be a reflection of all that you are, that your glory may shine in your church and draw this world to you. We pray this for Jesus' sake. Amen. So, for our consideration today, we have three rather different texts and stories that relate God's great love to his people. I think if there's sort of a unifying thread and theme that runs through here, it is God's stance towards his world. God's stance towards his world. And that's all wrapped up in how we view God. And of course, how we view God then also impacts how we look at others. The great command, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, is also tied up in the Great Commission, and that we go out and we spread that message of hope, all that Jesus has taught us. So let's take a look at these texts and use that theme to look at not only how God is doing his work, but what he calls us to as well. So the first story is one of Abraham and Sarah, and at this time Abraham is 99, and so this couple is really old. Now I say that, of course, because I'm not 99. For those, actually we have a member in our congregation who's 101, so you know, there is a certain limitation that comes with age. And the story unfolds out of other stories that have preceded. And there is a buildup of this hope that is created in Abraham and Sarah for a son, someone to carry on the line, someone to inherit the promises of God, that God has called Abram out of his own family and out of his own home and called him to this country that God is going to give him, and God hasn't given it yet, nor has God given him a son. And so there is this struggle that is going on with Abraham and Sarah's faith. Now, we read in previous chapters that Abraham believed God and God credited it to him as righteousness. And yet there is this tension that continues with Abraham struggling to own the promises of God, Abraham and Sarah both. And now they are approaching their last years, right? Okay. And they're wondering how this is going to happen. And so God comes to them periodically, and the stories that are recorded seem to be sort of jam-packed with God coming to them, and yet, you know, there are years that separate one visit to the next, and they don't hear from God for quite a while. So we have a sort of typical scene that shows up in the Middle East of travelers on the road coming and receiving the standard hospitality of that day if there were travelers going by and they stopped, you were expected that you would provide for them the best of what you had, something to drink, a time of refreshment, food, just to extend that hospitality to those who passed by. And Abraham is quick to do this. And at this particular point, we don't really know whether Abraham knows who this is. Hard to say. I mean, he may have in some way recognized that God was coming to visit. It sounds as though it is sort of a typical greeting and a typical response for any traveler that might be on the road. And so as they're coming, he prepares this feast and they sit down and then comes sort of the startling question, where is your wife, Sarah? Yeah, I would imagine that it was not common knowledge for travelers to all of a sudden know who the wife was, and even to ask about her. Sarah's name has just been changed in the last couple of chapters from Sarai to Sarah, and calling her this mother of many nations is there's something going on. And Abraham says, well, she's in the tent behind me, as was appropriate in that day, according to the culture. And then it becomes clear that this visitor is not simply another person. This is God himself. And he issues this promise again. And now he makes it more specific. This time next year, Sarah will have a son. And Sarah laughs. And it's obviously, from our scripture, it's a laughter of disbelief. Yeah, really. And you would think that, you know, as we think about those things, that that when God shows up, what a powerful thing that must be. And obviously, in faith, we would believe everything that God would tell us. But actually, in Scripture, time and time again, when God comes and shows up, people have a hard time believing. Belief is not such a simple thing. Matter of fact, it's just in previous chapters where Abraham is told that he's going to have a son, and he laughs. Sarah is not the only one who laughs at this. Abraham laughs as well. They both struggle with this. It has been a challenge for them to accept this in faith. And the amazing thing, I think, is that God's stance toward them, even in their disbelief, is that he confronts it, number one. He says, you know, why did you laugh? And he doesn't let her off the hook. Yes, you did laugh. And the beauty of that shows up in Genesis 21. And I've got to read this little section for you. Because at the following year, when Sarah gives birth to a son, this is what she says. Sarah said, God has brought me laughter. And everyone who hears about this will laugh with me. And she added, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. Now, it's a wonderful story, and it's full of good stuff. But you have to ask the question, so why didn't God just simply come to Abraham and Sarah 50 years ago and give them a son? Abraham had believed, God credited to him his righteousness. He had followed God, and Sarah had followed with him, and they were God's people. Why didn't he give Isaac way back when they could have enjoyed him much longer, and why not? And we don't know, do we? Not for any real specific reason, except that you will find in Scripture this longing for a son. The longing for the coming of the son, a son who will fulfill the promises of God. Abraham and Sarah didn't know that. But there is being built up within the history of the people of Israel this longing for the coming of a son. And God, in his graciousness, even with the faithlessness of Abraham and Sarah, still visits them, and a son is born, and appropriately named Laughter. And God turns the laughter of disbelief into the laughter of joy. What a beautiful story. And so when Paul writes to the Roman Christians, he is writing to a group of people who are actually several groups of people, Jews and Gentiles alike, and they are struggling with getting along with each other. And it is not an easy thing. And so Paul is sort of pulling people back to their basics. And he's identifying, look, this is our common ground. We have been justified not because of our heritage, our Jewish roots. We have been justified because we believe in Jesus Christ. Jews and Gentiles alike come to God in the same area, in this same openness that God has. While we were still sinners, while we were full of sin, while we had no power in ourselves, that's God's stance. That's how God chooses to treat us. So that with no worth of ourselves, being worthless, being sinners, God chooses to make this first step and plant his Spirit in our hearts to desire him, to grow, to repent, and to stimulate and to grow that faith that we now place in Jesus Christ for our salvation. And he places that within us, this hope as well, this hope of the glory of God. This hope of the glory of God. Now, you might think, first of all, that what we hope for isn't necessarily the glory of God, right? I know that's a good thing to hope for, we would say, but we hope for the new heavens and the new earth. We hope for when sin is destroyed and death is destroyed and there is no more sickness, and there is no more breakdown in society, and there are no more goodbyes, and there's no more divorce, and there's no more of all of this stuff that sin has caused. Oh, that's what we hope for. And if truth be told, we probably hope for a nice-sized mansion. Yeah. Let me tell you about hoping the hope of the glory of God. The glory of God is where we see the fingerprints of God all over. We see it in creation. And you can see it in bits and pieces if you look outside, in the singing of the birds, in the beauty of the skies, in the gorgeous colors and flowers and the beauty of song and the very best of a great meal, the very best of what it means to be connected with each other in community and in love. That's where the glory of God is. And so when we talk about the hope of the glory of God, that means our lives are sinless and pure, and we are whole. And Paul writes about what seemed to be very applicable at this time. We glory in our sufferings. Yes, we glory in our sufferings. Why? Because when sufferings are treated appropriately from the proper perspective, suffering produces perseverance. We can stick through this because we have this hope. We can continue on faithfully because we have this hope. Suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character. The development of character in God's eyes is much more important than our wealth. And character produces hope. That people of character have a richness of hope and an intentionality about putting off satisfying my desires now because I have this hope within me. That's character. Hope does not put us to shame. Hope in what God has in store for us does not put us to shame. Because God's love has already been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. Here's the deal, folks. We are in the time of Pentecost. The Spirit has been poured out. God's love has been poured out into our hearts. What an incredible gift we already have. This is God's love. It is present and active and alive in us. And the more that we are in tune with the Spirit, the more that we are in step with the Spirit, the more that the fruit of the Spirit is being grown in us, the more that our gifts are being displayed and used for the good of the community and for the coming of the kingdom, God's love is more and more evident in our hearts. And so God's love is revealed especially in Jesus Christ. That in Jesus Christ, we see what it means to be fully human and what that looks like and how we as the church are to be the body of Christ. And you have in Matthew 9, a sort of repeat of the beginning of Jesus' ministry in Matthew 4. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. That's the preface to the Sermon on the Mount. If you remember, I preached on that probably about 4 or 5 months ago. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. So when Jesus goes about, that's the active verb, Jesus goes, sort of reminds you of what the Great Commission is. Go, make disciples. And then there's three participles here, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. All three of those are this spreading of the kingdom that Jesus is proclaiming. That there's good news for people. That what we are about is good news. That we have a teaching of a different way of life, different way of looking at things, different way of living with each other in a community. And that there is healing as a very core part of the values that we have, that we are a place of healing and wholeness. This is where Jesus does his work. In seeing the crowds, our text says, in seeing the crowds, which begs the question, how do you look at crowds? How do you look at crowds? Of course, nowadays we look at crowds with, oh dear, they're not socially distancing. It's kind of weird looking at a movie and seeing people sitting at the same table in a restaurant because that's just, you don't do that. Ah! There is that fear in us, you know, in terms of crowds. So that's one piece that we're dealing with now. But in terms of a crowd of people, you know, you see a crowd of people and what do you see? This is God's stance. God's stance toward Abraham and Sarah. God's stance toward sinners. God's stance toward crowds. He looked at the crowds and didn't say, oh my, look at all the work I have to do. Did he? He looked at the crowds and his heart went out to them. The word compassion means you have this pain in your gut And it hurts, not for yourself, but for them. Because he saw them in reality. They were harassed and helpless. And I think of those who feel helpless nowadays. Those who feel harassed nowadays. When we look at crowds, we have a tendency to ascribe to them motivations. And sometimes that reveals more about our hearts than it does about their hearts. God's stance toward the crowds was one of compassion. He saw that they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. He didn't blame, he didn't judge. His compassion was what was evident. And then he calls his disciples. And if you were following the text, you probably heard he sent them out. But before he sends them out, he says something. He says, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. He looks at the crowds and his heart goes out to them and he sees all of that need that he has the answers to, that he has the healing for, that he has a community in which they can be enfolded. And he says, the workers are few. And then he says, go and be a worker. No, he doesn't. He says, pray to the Lord of the harvest. Pray to the one who is master of the harvest, the one who owns the harvest, to send out workers into his harvest field. Okay? Prayer is where it starts. You know, it is in prayer, I think, that our hearts are shaped and changed, because as we pray for God to send laborers into the harvest field, the thought might occasionally strike us that maybe we ought to participate in the answering of that prayer as well. And if we are not willing, at least we can pray, God, make me willing to be willing. Make me willing to be changed, to look at the crowds the same way you do, and to go to them in compassion with the gifts and fruit that you have given me, and out of that to do your work. And he sends out the 12, and he finishes the sending with these words, freely you have received, freely give. Freely you have received, freely give. Now, we've earned what we got, right? We've worked hard for what we've got. We've got education that we've worked toward. We have, and this is our stuff, right? Well, if there's ever been an unbiblical statement, that would be that one. This is all God's world. He's made it all. He's given us everything. He's given us life. He's given us abilities. He's given us time. It's all his. It is. It is. We have his salvation. We have this inheritance. We have this hope. We have this life. Excuse me. Amazing what we have. You have received all of this free. Now, freely give. Freely give. And the call to the church comes today in this time of need. In this time of need. So, God stands toward the world. The church's stance toward his world. How will you be? Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God in heaven, make us willing to be changed. Open our eyes to see the crowds, to see the harvest. And, O Lord, send out workers into the harvest field. for the harvest is ripe and ready. Help us, Lord, to see the harvest, to long to see the wholeness that you long for as well, to be equipped to do your work in your harvest, and to use all that we have for your glory and the coming of your kingdom. For Jesus' sake, amen. Our song of response is, "We are called," and here it is, that we have been called as God's people not to live lives of ease, but to work in his kingdom. We are called, the three verses. Our gifts and offerings to the Lord, not only our finances, but also our time and our talents. We are called to serve God in our offerings. And so as it's time of stewardship and in our time of offering, I'd like you to reflect on how God is calling you and where he is calling you and to whom he is calling you, that we may be open to the work of his Spirit and the growth of his kingdom. And for Grace Church in particular, this is the month when deacons are calling us to serve God by offering gifts as well for the work of the Lamb Center, which is a shelter for the homeless in Fairfax City. So please consider that and to be able to give generously. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, how you have blessed us abundantly beyond what we deserve. And we pray, O God, that you would take these gifts of ours and use them for the work of your kingdom. Hear our prayer, for we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Receive God's parting blessing. The grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, the power and presence of His Holy Spirit abide in you now and forever. Amen. Our doxology is taken from Song of Hope, the first verse.
Thank you. Amen.